All right, for those that are online, are you able to see the new notes? These are not. And hear me okay? Okay, great. Thanks, Carson. Put it over here. Okay. All right, so we're moving to the next section. So this is section unit two. So we're going to start learning a new technique. So far, we have learned how to solve RLC circuits. There we go. Okay, that really looks much better. Okay, so RLC, we've learned so far using we know a beginning value, we know an end value, and we can figure out the characteristic of how it moves in between those two positions. So that's basically how we've been solving the RLC so far. So what happens now when we get to those neither circuits? We haven't learned how to solve those. Or if we have multiple capacitors, multiple inductors, and we have more than just a second order, what if our input is not just a DC input? So far we've only looked at DC input. What if we have an AC input? All of these things lead to, okay, there must be other techniques. So that's where we're gonna move next. So this one is a critically damped RLC in series. And I've already gone through and solved how to do this just using the techniques we already learned. And so I wanted to just have this, so we're gonna go and use a different technique today and then come back and compare the answer. So this will be the end answer for this one. So the other techniques that are going to get us to, make sure you can read these. Okay, so in 1240, you guys learned what was called a phasor technique. So the phasor was where you knew one specific frequency, and then you could determine the rest of the circuit by changing those, like the inductor you changed to J omega L, and you use that omega from the input frequency. Same thing with the capacitor, one over J omega C, and that omega was determined by the input frequency. So you were only able to determine one specific frequency solution. So that is what the phasor can do, is it can have a sinusoidal input, but you only get one answer pretty much. And it's at the steady state end value, it will give you one value. It doesn't tell you anything between what is called the transient, which is, well, what happens in between the beginning and the end. And so that's where we learn these new other techniques. So the next one is using the Fourier domain and Fourier series. I usually never use that one. The ones that are the most common are going to be the Laplace transform and then the Fourier transform. So both of these give a complete solution. They're going to tell us all the information, all the transient, all the steady state, and it's going to give us also over a whole bunch of frequencies. So we can put in any frequency and determine from that answer what it is. So we don't have to know a specific frequency. We can do it in a generic form of all frequencies. So we're first gonna look at the Laplace transform. Then we're gonna do in the next section, we move to the Fourier transform. So those are the last two techniques that we're gonna learn on how to solve these. So the steps are similar to how you learned in phasors. You have a time domain circuit. You can create those differential equations like you did in the lab and how I first solved the RL and RLC circuit. So you can get a general differential equation. That is the hardest way to go about solving it. And so what we want to do instead is change it into what is called the S domain directly. And so we're going to go right from that time domain, look at the circuit, change it into the S domain. The thing about differential equations in the S domain is that they give us algebraic solutions. So we have algebraic equations, and now we can multiple, divide, add, subtract, and it's so much easier to get an answer. And then we're in the end going to take that inverse Laplace transform to get back to the time domain. So this way is way easier to work in this, what we call the imaginary domain. And this is the reason why this was developed, was so that we can take these differential equations, and instead of having to integrate and differentiate, we can just add and divide and add, subtract, multiply, and divide.
You've been doing for years already.
Yeah, all the math we already know. So the technique, though, is how do we get to the Laplace transform? So that's what we're going to learn next, is transforming the circuit into that S domain. Then we're going to use the techniques we've already learned, and you're going to see I like node voltage still. We use a lot of node voltage to solve. You're going to solve for any unknown variable now that you want to solve in the circuit, so you don't have to do it just for VC or IL. It can be any variable in there, and then all you do is transform it back to the time domain. Sounds pretty simple, but there's little tiny details in there that we'll get to. So the first thing is, how do we change to the Laplace domain? So you take, yes?
So the Laplace method is an alternative to doing phasors.
So phasors, again, you can only do it if you know the input frequency.
Okay.
So the phasor is going to be very limited in what information you can do, but it's similar in that you change it into the time, from the time to the frequency and then back. If you know a frequency, phasor's just as easy. You can determine exactly what the impedance is for the inductor, exactly what the impedance is for the capacitor. But most of the time, you're going to be designing things, so you're going to want to know, well, what happens over a whole bunch of frequencies? And you're going to need to know that as a designer. So yes, you can use it to solve for one specific frequency, but most applications are not going to be limited to just one frequency. So this is the Laplace transform. It integrates that time domain function, and you multiply it by e to the minus st. And so that is the actual formula to be able to get this. So you can do this for unknown Laplace transforms, but otherwise there are tables that have Laplace transform pairs. So it shows you when you have this function, putting it into that integration and multiplying it by e to the minus st, it results in, you can see here on the right side, is the Laplace transform part of it. If you have that function in the Laplace in the S domain, and you want to go back to the time domain, these are the transforms. So you're going to see very commonly that we use a lot of these, and that they're going to look very similar. So we have a lot of cosines, sines in the time domain, so you're going to see a lot of times, you know, this kind of a function in the Laplace domain. So, you know, you have shifts of sine, you have cosine, so a lot of times you're going to see these. We also see a lot of exponential functions, and so the exponential function, you know, you can just look at these tables and not have to integrate every single time. Yeah, so tables are there, go look up a table. You're great. So this is going to be the table you're going to use a lot. So this is how you transform the signal itself. So when I have any input signal, I can be like, oh, I can transform that into the Laplace domain. Or I can do the integration if it's not one of these and actually get a value. So a lot of times you'll have, say, an environmental signal, such as your voice, will be a whole bunch of summations of like sinusoids. And so you would have then a whole bunch of summations. So once you get a mathematical description, though, of an environmental situation, you can then change it always into the S domain. And so a lot of times it will be a summation of a whole bunch of different signals. And so a very complicated signal, such as my voice, I could actually use as an input into any system now. So the other thing we need to know is the elements themselves. How do we change the elements that are those time-dependent elements? So this is going to be your inductor and capacitance. So with the inductance, so the resistor stays the same. So this is the time domain table into the S domain table. So the resistor stays exactly the same. The inductor changes to, remember you have VL is equal to L DIL DT. And then when you integrate that, you have a differential in, I'm not explaining this very well. I'm gonna have to think about how to explain this better. But when you go back into the S domain from that integration, you're going to end up with a combination of an addition. So you're gonna have that the voltage across the whole inductance is gonna be the inductor value of SL, so that's where SL times IL, and then the polarity of this is gonna be opposite, and it will be a minus L IL. And zero minus is the initial value before times zero. Yes?
On the tables.pdf in unit 2, they have this table right here is cut off about halfway through the left side of the table.
On where?
On the tables.pdf under the unit 2.
Oh, really?
Yeah.
Okay, I will have to repost those, it sounds like. So on the lecture part or on this one?
Just the first Laplace tables that I felt.
Okay. I'll reprint those out. Yeah, those did get cut off. And on this one, there is some additional common transforms. So a lot of times you may see this exponential times the cosine, and especially in higher level classes, you're gonna see this one. And so these are another couple transforms that you're gonna commonly see. Okay, so I will correct this table. Thanks for calling that to my attention. But for now, it looks like this. So you have options. So depending on your circuit, you can either put the inductance with the voltage, or if you want them to be in parallel, you can do an inductance and current source. So either one of those, depending on your circuit, and you, whichever one you feel is going to be the most helpful to be able to solve the circuit for the variables. So you have a choice of which one you want to do. For IL, it's going to be a description of VL over SL, so the value still is still SL. And then the current source value will be that initial value over S. And so you have the two components. And for the capacitor, you are going to have, again, a voltage source in series with the capacitance, and again, 1 over SC. And then this one has the VC over S, and this one has the C times the voltage. And so this one goes up, so make sure your polarities are correct because they're different for whichever one you're using. So make sure to look at these to make when you redraw them so that you have the right directions. So what we're gonna do is we're going to take the Laplace transform of the input signal. We're gonna replace the inductance with one of these, whether it's a inductance and the voltage or the inductance in current. And then the capacitor, same thing, we're gonna replace it with this model. Then we can solve the circuit. Does that make sense? Yes, no? Okay, sort of there. Okay, so that's what we're gonna go do. We're gonna go back to that problem and solve this one. So for this one, you can see that there's going to be the switch is going to determine like my time at zero minus. And then sometimes it will be the input signal will be what's going to determine it. So let me get my notes, lecture two, five, and notes. Okay. Sorry. Okay, so we're going to solve for I of t. Okay, I have these down here. Oh. Before I move on. Okay, so there's, oh, and I forgot to mention the inverse Laplace. So the inverse Laplace is this function where you take the S domain function, F of S, multiply by EST, and then you're differentiating in terms of S. And then you have to take the 1 over 2 pi j. And then you integrate over the whole thing. So that's the inverse Laplace. Ends up being very yucky, so tables are great. Properties, though. So there's some properties in the time domain into the Laplace domain that we want. So if we have a multiplication of a constant in the time domain, it is going to remain a multiplication in the S domain. So this is a really nice property to make sure you understand. So when you integrate and you have a like a k value, you can just take it out of that integration. So that's why it's the same on both sides. If you're adding linearity, you have that, again, that k1 times the function. And again, it's just going to come out of that integration. And so you're going to have the addition in the S domain. For the, if you have a multiplication at the time, though, you're going to have a little bit different. So it's going to be that 1 over a, and then your Laplace transform f, and then you're going to take the s over a value. Time shift is another really common one where you may not look at it right at time 0, and so you're shifted. So ut minus t, what does that look like? Anybody have a guess? Okay, so you're just shifting it. So instead of shifting up at 0, so this is t minus 3, this will be at 3 seconds it goes up. So it shifts it. And so this is common if you have like a reference time that you're looking at and other signals are triggered after that time. So you would use something like that. A ut minus 3 to know that it's like after that time that I've specified to be 0. So this is a common one. So if you shift both the function by that time and the u of t by that time, then you end up with an e to the minus that t shift times s in the s domain. So what happens is a lot of times this will be shifted in the S domain, and then when you shift back, it will have that shift into it. So you may not see that until you kind of shift back, but the circuit itself will make that change. So this is a common one you're going to see. Not as commonly, you're going to see a multiplication of E in the time domain, which then shifts it in the frequency domain. There's the properties of the first derivative and second derivative. And this is where the table gets that initial value of that function at 0 minus. So a differentiation, you have s times f of s minus the initial value. And then second derivative, kind of so forth. When you integrate, you have a 1 over s. And then when you multiply by time in the frequent or in the time domain, it becomes a differentiation in the S domain. So these are very common properties that you're going to use for the Laplace train transforms. Yes.
So for the second time derivative, do we do a double integral then, or is
what do you mean by a double integral?
We take the integral twice, same object.
Yep. So you integrate it and then you reintegrate it. Yeah. So it's a double integral for that one, and so you integrate the first one, which gives you SFS minus F by minus the initial, and then you're going to integrate that or differentiate that again, and that's the integration of it again. And so that's where you get the S squared, because the S now comes out. So you multiply it all by S again, and then you have a new derivative initial value. So the derivative initial value will be like di dt. And so like if you're looking at a max value, that would be zero. So in your lab, you guys did that where you had the initial value of a derivative you set equal to zero. Okay, I don't know. Did that answer your question, Brian? Okay. All right, so okay. So using that, let me grab this property. I think that's a better way to describe this. Copy. Okay. All right, so using this differentiation, and we know that VL, I'm going to go back over and use VL was equal to L dIL dt. So using our initial knowledge of this, and then we take that, this becomes L, and then S IL of S minus L times the initial value. Oops, sorry, that was, the function is I. And so this becomes the I L of zero minus. So that's where the equation comes from. And then when you implement it, you can see the negative sign. That's where you get the polarity of the negative and the positive. So that's where that comes from. Does that make sense? Okay. All right. And then IL, the second one on the right that has the current source, comes from the integration one. And so it's the same thing where you take the property of the integration and then you rewrite that equation. And so solving that L di L dt, you have to integrate both sides. So you have VL dt and then plus the initial value, and then you divide by the L. So that's where that integration equation comes for IL. So same idea for the capacitor. So that's where those equations come from, is from just the original IC is equal to C dVC dt. And so IC then ends up being the S times V C times VC minus C times the initial VC of zero minus. Okay? Make sense? Okay, now we're gonna go solve. Okay, so this one, let me take these off. Okay. So, oh, I already copied in down there. Okay, so here's our initial value, or our initial circuit, and we need to find, we're trying to find, I forgot what we're trying to find, IL? Go back and see, IL, I of T. Okay, so I of T is the current going through both the capacitor and the inductor. So we don't know what the input Vs is here. So we're gonna leave V, or Vs of T, so we're gonna leave Vs of T as kind of a generic, it could be any input signal. So we're solving the circuit for what we call the transfer function. And the transfer function is a way to describe, so it describes output based on input. So an example would be that if my output is X and my input is Y, this is a description, a very simple one, of just X is equal to six times Y. Maybe I'll put this as in terms of input and output. Okay, so say I'll do Vn, and so six times Vn is equal to Vout. Whoops. So Vout makes more sense, I think. Okay, so So we usually typically describe the transfer function as a ratio of Vout over Vn is equal to some function, in this case 6. So this is how we would describe our transfer function, is that you just take the variable Vn and you divide it over to the other side, and it's kind of an unknown. If Vn is 6, what is our output here? 36. If Vn is 1, 6. So it makes it nice that, like, this is an easy example, but that's the same idea as we get to complicated circuits. So what we're going to do is describe this transfer function in terms of Vout over Vn, and instead of 6, it will be a function in terms of S, if we're in the S domain, and then we're going to change it back into the time domain to get the time domain function. So this is what we're going to try and do for all of the solutions so that we can know, like, Vn we don't know yet, but we can pick any input and be able to still solve this circuit. So, all right, so Vs we just change into the large Vs of S. Then we need to change the capacitor. And so our capacitor is not moving very well. Okay. So we replace the capacitor. And then we're going to replace the inductor. And these are hooked to the specific nodes. So we pretty much are just erasing them and redrawing them as such. So the values we don't know here are those initial values. Oh, oops, that's not what I meant. Erase. Okay, I think we're good. And then we're going to solve this in the end time. So we're going to put the switch into the last position, and then we're going to solve this to get the values of those initial values for 0 minus, so before the switch moves. And we do that the same way we've done before. So to find those initial values, I need another circuit. So before the switch moves, we have the switch is open. And this acts as an open, and this acts as a short. So open. And open here, and so VC and then this x is a short. So IL So what is VC? IL? Okay. So we're going to use those initial values of 0 for both of them, which makes this one easier to solve. So with these 0, that means that this will be a short here, and this will be a short there. So then we just have the circuit here, where this is VS, and this is the 1 over CS, and this is SL. Now we treat these just like resistances.
That was the question.
Yep.
It's just like impedances.
Uh-huh. These are called impedances. They're complex impedances, but they act now just like resistors. So treat like resistors. And we call them a complex impedance. But they act just like resistors. So we want to solve for this I. How are we going to write the equation for I here?
Yes, over 4 plus 1 over CS plus SL.
Correct. Oh, sorry. So I is just going to be VS over the summation of all of those. So 4 plus 1 over CS plus SL. And that is our answer. So it would be I over VS for the transfer function itself. Sorry, yeah. All right. Uh-huh. Yep. So here I'm going to plug in the numbers. So C was 0.1 farad. L was 0.4 Henry. And in order to get a full transform, I'm going to do an input. So VS of T, I'm going to let be 1.6 U of T. So 1.6 U of T, you look back at the table, what was U of T transform? So 1.6 is going to be the same value. So the U of T was going to be what transforms? Anybody have? Go back and look at the table. Uh-huh. So this then just becomes 1.6 over S. And we put that in for VS. And then plugging in these values, I get 4 plus 1 over 0.1S plus 0.4S. And then I'm going to bring this S is actually going to be multiplied on the bottom there. So I have I is 1.6. I bring the S down, so this becomes 4S. And 1 over 0.1 becomes 10. And then the 0.4 becomes, or 0.4 stays, and I get S squared for that one. So then I need to factor these to be able to get into the form of the table. So the forms on the table had just like S plus something or S squared plus something squared. This doesn't match any of those. So I'm going to factor this. To factor it, I'm going to bring out the 0.4 And I can use the quadratic equation only if I have, let me go back to the quadratic equation. Ax squared plus bx plus c equals 0 gives me values for x equal to minus b plus or minus square root of b squared minus 4ac over 2a. So this is going to give me two values, but these are going to be the roots of those values. And they don't give me the number out in front of the s squared. So in order to use these, bring out the number in front of the s squared first and then factor them. Otherwise you won't get the right numbers. So I bring out the 0.4 and then this becomes s squared plus 4 over 0.4s plus 10 over 0.4. And that ends up being 16 over 0.4 becomes 4 on the top. Yes, sorry. 1.6, thank you. 1.6 over 0.4 is 4. And then s squared, and then 4 over 0.4 becomes 10s, and then 10 over 0.4 is 25. Can you guys see what this factoring is? Yeah. Again, if you don't see it, you can use the quadratic formula, or you can use an online tool, but s plus 5 and s plus 5. So it'll be s plus 5 squared. And now we're going to go back up and look at the table. So we have 4 over s plus 5 times squared. So that gives us this one. So that's going to be this transform. And so what is our A in this case?
5.
Okay. So we have TE to the minus 5T U of T. And this is going to be I of T.
And we have to multiply by 4.
And multiply by 4, thank you. Yes. And yes, you do need to multiply by the 4. So I of t. Okay, so here it is, 4t e to the minus 5t u of t. And we can go back and check the other solution, and we got the same answer. 4t e to the minus 5t, t greater than 0.
Okay.
Yep. So a little easier than going through all of these steps of finding B1, B2, D1, D2, omega naught. So in some ways it may be simpler. Other ways, it depends on the circuit itself. Some ways it might be a little bit more complicated. But in general, this is typically an easier technique. And it also gives us the really big power of something like this. Like, this is an input signal that is very complicated. How would I describe this signal mathematically?
It would be 6 times 2 different step functions. If I remember what those would be in this case,
one of them is u of t.
Okay. Yep, so u of t will be one of them. So that's going to give us this graph, where right at 0 it will go up to 6. So this is 6 u of t.
Is it like 1 minus u of t or something?
Because
it's not trying to
come off. Okay, so we want to subtract this portion off, right? Here. So it will be 0 after that. So this is going to be at 1. So this would be minus it. So this would be 6 u of t minus 1. And so this would be described as 6u of t minus that, minus 6u t minus 1. Does that make sense? Okay. So we're only wanting it to be, you know, here. So this will go up, and then it's going to subtract those two off, so you would get that function. So transforming this, and then in this case, where's your 0 minus going to be? So this is the question. What will be your input source value at 0 minus? It's going to be 0. So you're going to apply 0 to find those initial values on IL and IC. And so what will that give you here for your initial values of IL? And VC of 0. Both of them will be 0. Okay? All right, go ahead and work in small groups and try to solve the rest of this. And you're finding IC of T. Sorry, there you go. And you won't be able to change this back to the time domain because we don't have all the values in there. So just find, so sorry, this is not IC of T, so find IC of S.
I think that was the it's like by right here redrawing it and like setting up the equations.
So the first thing you want to transform this into the
I just use imagine these ones. Yeah, it's just like that. So it's like that.
You can come out.
Great.
Just go to the
So
you have two cards, right? These ads.
The
first one will be yours to
put it.
This is really the.
I didn't use that with those pigments.
Okay. Yeah. Whatever that
is.
So it's pretty close.
Okay.
So he takes it out.
So I made it this. And then I said, okay, cool, we'll say 10.
Wow.
So this is going to be IS and S.
Let's figure out what races. So I did the last transform trans IS. Or is that IS?
Say 0
is IS. So you just
and then
did the Laplace.
And you use the T minus T, so you can get one
here. So you can get IS and S.
He did the
so
best.
So I did. So where did I And then I said, okay, well, that is
I'll talk about
right.
I'll talk about
if I
So the first step here is going to be to change. So first you want to change the IS of T to IS of S. And so looking at the tables, we have U of T is transformed into 1 over S. And then U of, oh, I guess I could have just done both of these. And then the shift is U of T minus T. So those become so the 6 comes out, and then you have 1 over S for the first one, the U of T portion, and then a minus U of T minus 1 will become minus E to the S over S. And then I'm going to call that VX node and do node voltage there, so I have a minus IS plus VX over R plus VX over, and sorry, I didn't change these. So this is going to be SL and 1 over CS because the initial values are 0. I don't have to put those in there. And so this becomes SL plus VX over 1 over CS equals 0. And then I can solve that for VX. So 1 over R plus 1 over SL plus CS equal to IS. And then I can combine the bottom numerators. So this becomes SLC RC and then S squared LC squared. I think I did that right. RSLC. Okay, 1 over R, 1 over SL, and then this becomes S, right, I'm missing an R, let's see, R, S, L's cancel, and then the C, I think. And then I multiply that to the top, so R, S, L, C. S squared L C squared R plus SLC plus RC. And then I can bring, there's a C on all of these, it looks like C squared. Anyway, I can reduce that down more. And then I plug in the IS from the beginning, so that is 6 over S minus 6E to the minus S over S. And then this will reduce down to S squared, and then S squared plus S over RC plus 1 over LC. Oops, LLC. And then from here, I can get the values, actually make a fraction, and then translate it back into the time domain.
We were solving VX.
Oh, sorry. So, oh, yeah. Sorry, this is not VX. This is IC. Oh, my. Okay. So from VX value, IC was going to be VX over 1 over CS. So you treat these just like resistors, and the voltage above it was VX, and so you divide it by the impedance. So this is IC times VX times CS. And then that's this one. All right, questions? Yes, Marley.
In a case like this where we're not, like it's complicated and we're not necessarily taking it all the way back to the time domain,
mm-hmm.
where do you like stop? Like as soon as you have an IC equals, do you have to, like is there a certain point you need to simplify it to?
Typically, like you'll want to try and put it into a specific form where you can translate it back. So you would want to try and do the fractions or the S plus whatever components, if you can.
Would it have been possible to have just, once we got the impedances of all the components, wouldn't it have been possible to just treat this as a voltage division problem to get to IC?
Current divider, yeah. So you could use the current divider equation, and it will give you the same. But if you don't remember the current divider equation, you can just do node voltage and then take the voltage over the impedance to get the current there. All right, any other questions? Okay, so one more technique that we're going to need to learn to do this is called partial fraction expansion. So that will be what we'll work on probably next week. So just start watching the other learning material and make sure you're understanding this technique. All right. See you guys next week.